I was 25, single, living in Minneapolis, and writing an advice column called Dear Jenny X, named by a boomer for our local newspaper. Overworked and underpaid, I was experiencing the glory of the workforce for the first time. I made all the mistakes. I wore white after Labor Day. I put aluminum in the microwave. I wore 3-inch heels to a lawn party. But a lot of things went well, too, like meeting a delightful new friend named Harriet from Wales through my boss at the paper. We hit it off immediately. She was in town for 6 months before returning back to the UK. We became fast friends. Soon enough, she had to leave for home in Wales, and she invited me to fly out and visit her for a month in the summer. So, an English major, I'd always wanted to check out Tintern Abbey, Glastonbury, and Stonehenge. So I went. But the best thing I would check out in Wales was Harriet's brother. Joe is a strapping guy and built like an oak tree. He was a ginger with long red hair that brushed his broad shoulders golden brown from working in the sun. He still had dirt underneath his fingernails. When I met him, he was lounging in their converted cider mill and reading that book Perfume by Patrick Susskind, a sexy book about smells and intrigue that I had just read on the plane. Coincidence? Joe smelled like peat moss, testosterone, and literacy. It was hard to take the Nebraska out of the girl, so I still had big mall hair with rooster bangs. I smelled like vanilla, glitter, hair products, and possibility. Now, it's not always the best idea to fuck your best friend's brother. But the simmering attraction was immediate and mutual, and Harriet signed off on the summer fling. I appreciated her European sensibilities. So it was on. Joe stomped grapes at the local vineyard that summer, and I found that so hot, that kind of contained recklessness. He came home from work with port-stained feet and mysterious patterns and a whiff of grape juice on top of his signature smell. Plus, I was coming off a breakup with an uptight accountant that stressed me out so much, the skin on my face broke out in a rash, especially around my mouth. So, but Joe was an Aquarius with a Cancer moon. Listen, he was emo, sensitive, big picture, and visionary. He didn't mind my face rash. He was too busy stomping grapes, wooing me with the thrill of his English accent, and shagging me senseless in the cider mill. Now, as these things sometimes go, after a month of fun, I ended up with a yeast infection. On the day before, I was flying back home when I yeast expected it. So the stress of going back home had amped up my face rash, which was super painful if not medicated, and I was out of that cream too. So Harriet took me to the British pharmacy Boots for a consult. Now, thrush was the Brits' equally charming name for a yeast infection. The pharmacist gave me a pill for thrush. He also advised me to not wear underwear on the 9-hour plane ride, to let it all breathe, he said. And he said they only had opaque medication for my face. I said, that's fine. What I didn't realize was what opaque meant. It means not clear. A nice clown white. Like a successful blowjob, like the remains of the day. Opaque. So, for my plane ride home, I wore that opaque white cream along with my humiliation, a jacket, a knee-length skirt, and no underwear, per the instructions. despite the skin issues on my face, I was feeling good. I was feeling serviced. And I was going commando. How daring. What freedom. Just after the takeoff, I made my way down the narrow aisle into the cramped airplane lavatory. Oh, but wait. My period was a week early. So first, I was relieved I wasn't bearing Joe's child. But then I froze. Wait, I had 9 hours left on this plane. And I had no tampons, and I was wearing a skirt with no underwear. I realized at any moment I'd have a torrent of blood running down my legs. I always had an allegiance to tampons and a hot, deep shame about menstruation. That went way back to fifth grade, when I got my period. I was embarrassed because I was in fifth grade. And didn't tell anyone, not even my mom. I just could not handle my parents saying, "You're a woman now." I was 10. I still had Holly Hobby sheets and a Hello Kitty backpack. I didn't wear a bra yet. There were no red tent ceremonies in rural Nebraska where I grew up. There was nothing to formally welcome me, an elementary school menstruator, into the monthly mystery of menses. So I handled the situation alone, true to my Scorpio moon. I took money from my paper route, and I walked to the grocery store to buy my first ever box of maxi pads. So there was something called a tampon, which was shaped like a test tube from science class, but that seemed advanced. Maxi pads, however, turned out to be a disaster. Part diaper, part flotation device, and they were so loud. Crinkle, crackle, swish, swash. They stuck out an inch in every direction, never stayed in place, and always ended up looking like a crime scene. I had to crack this tampon thing. I didn't have any sisters to consult, so I called up Deirdre Burroughs, rotary style, on our pea green kitchen phone. Deirdre was the fifth grade fixer. Competent, trustworthy, a crack researcher. We all had a Deirdre Burroughs. I stretched the curly phone cord all the way into the laundry room and under the locked door by the wooden sign that said, "A penny saved is a penny earned." I laid on the floor so she could talk me through the insertion. I had questions. I was 10. If it stuck up too far, would it poke out my belly button, come out my mouth? I mean, the logistics felt mysterious. But lo and behold, it stayed put, even if I did a cartwheel. I mean, I could jump rope with this thing. Tampons were so much better. They did come with a terrifying pamphlet about toxic shock syndrome, but at least people couldn't hear you coming. I was never going to wear maxi pads again, ever. I was a tampon girl. So now back in the plane lavatory, or about 180 periods later. I'm having some PTSD realizing that I'm going to have to publicly hunt down a tampon in the next 10 minutes. Or soon there would be blood everywhere, which would be unhygienic, uncomfortable, and totally embarrassing, period. Suddenly desperate in the cramped stall, I realized I couldn't even do what thousands of other women have done for millennia and shove some brown paper towels from a public restroom into my underwear. Because there was no underwear. I asked a nearby female flight attendant restocking the snacks. She left to ask the lead flight attendant, my embarrassment growing. "Please do not let that person be a man," I thought. A minute later, the most handsome flight attendant ever created. Think Brad Pitt, circa Thelma and Louise, came strolling down the center aisle gingerly, holding a brown paper bag folded and stapled at the top. Here you go, he said, eager to get rid of the package. I looked inside. No tampons. Just a dozen plump maxi pads. So sweet. I mean, so sweet. He didn't understand that I'd only need a couple pads for the entire flight. I mean, that is if I had something to stick the pad to. Which I told him. I don't understand, he said. I know, I said. I know. I'll put it this way. I'm not wearing any underwear. He looked at me with disdain, looked uncomfortable, looked at the clown white medicine on my face, repeated it was all they had, wished me the best of luck, turned and walked back to first class where, frankly, he belonged. So increasingly desperate, I shuffled down the aisle and asked a few of the friendlier looking, potentially menstruating humans if they had a tampon. They didn't. So unfortunately, with every seat crammed on this fully occupied plane, quite a few strangers also overheard my request, adding to my hot veil of shame. I wanted the pilot to just make a quick announcement. This is your captain speaking. Please carry your check-ons for a tampon for the young woman in 6A. She's the one with the opaque white cream all over her face. Opaque means not clear. She needs a tampon specifically because she's not wearing any underwear due to one of those pesky lingering yeast infections after a rigorous month of shagging her best friend's brother. Eventually, a flight attendant corralled me back to my seat. You're making the other passengers nervous, she said. How'd she think I felt? Anxiety wasn't the only thing starting to flow freely through me. I would very soon look like an extra from Squid Game. So I took the brown paper sack of maxi pads into the lavatory, and suddenly inspiration struck. I got a vision of a London Bridge of maxi pads, each overlapping the next. I could jerry-rig this thing. I took the strips of plastic off and I got to work. Listen, I may not have had underwear, but I did have two inner thighs, which is where I stuck the outermost pads. Head held high, hair toss, I exited the lavatory with a smile on my face and waddled carefully and slowly down the aisle to my seat. If one pad is loud, then imagine the sound of five pads stuck together. But this time, it was the sound of freedom, ingenuity, and an intact self-esteem. Crinkle, crackle, swish, swash. When my flight landed in Minneapolis with white cream still smeared around my mouth, I shuffled proudly to the restroom, and I put a quarter in the wall, and out popped a tampon. Now, if this story was a panty liner with a light flow, you could say, don't fuck your best friend's brother. I mean, maybe. Or menses, like life is messy, yes. Or always have access to a pair of underwear, for sure. But I feel more super plus heavy flow about it. This story's about freedom. The great airplane tampon incident happened half a lifetime ago. I'm now 50 and in the confusing wake of menopause. It startled me to realize that this phase of my life, when our periods stop, gets served up with another helping of shame. We're shamed when we get our periods. We're shamed when we stop getting them. We're shamed when we don't have basic supplies to get us through a long plane ride or gym class or a work day. We're shamed when we wear underwear. We're shamed when we don't. All that shame is such a sham. So this story's for all of us who've MacGyvered the fuck out of something to do with the embarrassment of our bodies in a moment of sheer desperation. It's about freedom. Crinkle, crackle, swish, swash.
That's Elaine Gale, everybody.